Good morning, everyone. To start with, how many of you were there from the session yesterday? Okay, few people. Okay, perfect. So today, I'm actually going to start off with narrating an experience which I kind of went through and a thought which I went through about, I would say, a year ago when I started noticing certain things. So it was my last trip to US, and I reached there after a flight of 14 hours, retired, went through the immigration, customs, all of it, picked up my bags, and I'm like, okay, let's just go pick up the car. So I started going for the new car desk, quickly pick up the car, go to the hotel, I'm going to crash, I'm dead tired right now. And I get to the desk, and this is what I encounter. I want to do it fast. I need to wait in the queue for about an hour, 45 minutes, an hour and a half, just get to the counter, then do the paperwork, then do everything, then pick up the car, and then only I can drive to the hotel. Pretty frustrated. And I think it was somewhere else out there, may not be in that queue that day, but somewhere was frustrated with similar things. But unlike me, the person saw an opportunity, and this is what was born. How many of you know Flipkart? One person? Two? Okay. So what does Zipcar do? Zipcar is also a car rental company, but what they do is, you sign up for a membership. Once you are a member, what you do is you get your paperwork done, everything done once and for all. You get a mobile app, you get a membership card. You want a car? Order it in advance. It will be parked in a parking spot. You go there, touch the card on the windscreen, the car opens up, it's all yours. Use it, take it back, park in the same spot, lock it to the car, walk away, they'll come and pick it up. What did they do? With a very minimalistic investment, what they did was they challenged every single car rental company which is out there in kind of invested a lot in infrastructure, opening up offices and everything, and their geographical reach. They challenged everything using technology. What are your thoughts there? One more experience. And I think a lot of us might kind of go through this one. So depending on our families, once in a month, once in a day, once in a week, we would kind of go out for grocery shopping. Does everyone do that?
Yes.
So what I do is I typically try to go in the morning, want to finish that off fast so that I can save as much of my weekend as I can. And typically when I start from home, this is what I encounter. Okay? I'll go through this thinking that I'll go to the supermarket and this is what I'll find. I'll do my shopping nicely, but again there, surprise, this is what I find. The supermarket is doing best business, they are pretty happy with it, there is congestion everywhere, there are long queues on every counter, long queues on the billing counters. They are making money, they are pretty happy with it. Customers are not so happy, so what? Until someone else thinks of this. That's obvious, right? Right? But then what happens with this? Now supermarkets are not being challenged, a Big Bazaar or a Total is not being challenged by another of their variants. They are being challenged by a company which takes a year to cover almost all the major cities in India. What they have done over the last 10 years. So what does that tell? Does it ring a bell? Does it tell something? What do you guys think?
Innovation.
Okay?
It's changing fast.
Hmm? Mm-hmm. Yes. So that has me thinking in terms of what is happening. I mean, businesses which were built over 10 years, and Tathagat kind of mentioned something yesterday. If you look at S&P 500, every 2 weeks a company drops from that list. That's the mightiest of all 500 companies in the globe. 2 weeks a company drops. And the pace is, if you look at the history, the pace is actually increasing over the years. Companies entering and dropping from that list. So that had me thinking in terms of what is this phenomena, what is happening. I started looking around. Is there agility in there? Is there something? And when I looked at business agility, the first thing that certain people spoke to me was about how do we take agile processes and apply them in business? Which was like, I don't know, man, if it makes sense, because agile typically was coined very finely biased for software development. I don't know if you can do that. But when I started looking around, I found there is a concept called business agility. And Wikipedia defines it like this. It's the ability of a business system to rapidly respond to change by adapting its initial stable configuration. The keywords there are change and adapting. So you are changing and adapting not because of a competitor, because that's not a change, that's not adaptation, that's just forced. But you're actually trying to adapt to the changing environment. Another set of people who are pretty well known to define business agility are Forrester. This is how they define it. The transition to a digital business, mind the language there, digital business that allows an enterprise to embrace market, organization, and operational changing as a matter of routine. That to me is becoming the new business paradigm, where changes are to be done and you need to respond to the fast changing environment in order for you to be relevant in the business market as such. And that I think is going to be the next challenge that most of the established businesses are going to face. So if we take that thought and kind of look at it, I mean, we're talking about business environment changing. What is this business environment? What is changing? So look at the current business environment. These are the keywords that we keep hearing everywhere. Everyone today is talking about paradigm shift, data-driven, communication, blah, blah, blah. The reality there is that we are living in the age of data and information, right? Businesses need to adapt to the new information and the way data is being used. There are newer ways of engaging the customers. There are new delivery channels opening up. Businesses need to adapt to that, otherwise you're losing your customers. So if that is what is happening, what is enabling it? There are certain other key trends that I kind of found out I want to share with all of you. It's pretty data-oriented, last few slides. But I think that will probably have certain thoughts triggered off. Look at this. The global mobile data traffic projection from 2014 to 19. We're talking about 2.5 exabytes per month to it changing to about 24.3 exabytes per month in a matter of 5 years. That's huge growth that we're talking about. And our regular internet, laptop, and your desktop traffic is not growing at this rate. So this you're talking about increasing internet penetration and increasing mobile penetration, and increasing data penetration. That's what we're talking about. So a lot of this is also will be coming from newer people who will have access to internet. If this is not enough, look at this. This is 2014. In 2014, we as humans accounted for less than half of the internet traffic. More than half was by machines. And this is going to increase over time. Where are we heading? Just to corroborate that with one more thing, look at the installed base of connected things in smart cities. You're talking about 1.11 billion connected devices in 2015, and more than doubling in 2 years' time. So people used to imagine that maybe one day my fridge will order my groceries. I don't think that's too far away from where we are standing today.
Sir, please show the previous slides.
Hey, this is available on Statista, man. Don't take pictures. Just go to Statista and find this. These are publicly available data.
Okay.
So what difference should draw
from this? Hold it. These are trends. Just look at it. The way businesses are emerging, the way some of these things are emerging, and I think this is going to challenge us big time. Last but not the least, the internet is replacing the traditional media. Look at the growth in media consumption at 83.7%. 4 years, everyone else is dropping. So what I'm trying to point towards is, these trends, which are environmental, which are technology factor, will actually redefine the way business is being done, and the way business is being even conceived. Does that make sense? So if this is the reality of business, and this is how some of these things are happening, there are a few other technology trends which I think are already defining the way businesses are being set up. I will continue to do that. First one is open source. We have been talking about open source for I think at least 15 years that I've been hearing. But I think there's one big paradigm shift in open source. Today, you can actually take enterprise class applications from open source and get an enterprise started quickly. We have done that for a couple of our clients. Startups, you just picked up off the shelf open source, caught up and running, in no time they had an enterprise which would compete on scale with a lot of established enterprises. look at a lot of innovation, Hadoop and those kind of things, which are redefining the way businesses interact and get insights from their customers, all open source. To add to that, the second trend, which I think will redefine the face of a big industry out there, is open hardware. People today are talking about, and things are already out there in the market. I mean, I could get an attachment to my phone, which will have all my vital stats recorded. I can take my ECG at home, I can take my blood sugar at home, and I don't need to buy different machines. All just one attachment to my phone. That's the reality today. It's out there in the market. The companies are building businesses on top of that. Last but not the least, cloud computing enables a startup to scale and compete with any established enterprise today. So, if I am a business and if I'm looking at it, what should I be worried about? How does it impact me? First thing, which a lot of businesses were built on, was entry barriers. I am such a big organization. I have such a large infrastructure, it's very difficult for a new entrant to come and compete with me. Those thoughts and those barriers are vanishing. Technology has completely demolished those barriers. Second, my traditional delivery channels are no longer mainstream. I mean, you're talking about digital channels, you're talking about, you don't have to scale your infrastructure to actually engage with your customers. One of the complaints that I've heard from a lot of brands is about, say, if I sell on Flipkart. What gets delivered is a Flipkart guy goes and delivers a box. This is a brand experience. For example, if I'm buying Levi's or if I'm buying Rolex on Flipkart, anything like that, it's a brand experience which gets missed. There are people building businesses out of it. I know of a company which specializes working with e-commerce companies, looking at last mile delivery and actually creating their brand experience at your home when the product is being delivered. That's what businesses are doing these days. No, there's one more. There are a bunch of people working in that area, a bunch of startups in that area. Third one, the engagement model is changing. You no longer have to walk into a store to engage customers. Most of the engagement happens online, registered. Twitter, Facebook, that's where brands are engaging customers. And then technology is a business driver rather than an enabler. If you look at a lot of these companies are all tech companies. We're not talking about business guys, just these are mostly defining themselves as tech companies and are questioning what traditional businesses have been established on and have been doing. So, does it make sense so far? Are we actually feeling it that something like this is happening, or is it just that I have been dreaming about it?
If these already established businesses, if they know that these kind of tech companies are growing in 1 month or 2 months, why not they can do that thing?
That's a mindset change. And I think that those are the kind of things that I'm going to be pointing out, saying, you don't have to know, you have to be innovative.
Yeah, but they can have those things. They can ask consulting. They can do this.
The problem is, consulting always doesn't solve those kind of problems. A very hard true definition, and a lot of people laugh at it, is if a consultant will come, you ask him the time, he'll look at the time in your watch, tell you the time and give you a big bill. So a lot of these guys are innovating, they're innovating as their own thing. That's the difference.
So why technology is making it easier for anybody to come in, the challenge that I see is you've developed something great, how do you put it out there? I think that is still a barrier to entry in some way, because you can have a great technology that grocery shopping, for example, right? But even that requires the investment has gone down from establishing 1,000 retail stores, but you still need a huge marketing budget or something of that sort to sort of get you out there and actually acquire customers.
Absolutely.
Right, so.
Yeah. But I mean, the thing is that in terms of, if you look at online, right, the biggest entry barrier that people had, or Big Bazaar and these kind of people had, was in terms of reach. Okay, I have 200 stores across India, no one has that reach. People ask it, question it. I mean, in a year's time, they are in every city, and they're eating into the market like anything.
Is it more about solving the same problem differently? I mean, it's reaching to the customer in one form or the other, it's selling. So the business idea is not so new, but trying to solve the simpler mechanism is what more probably.
point that I'm trying to drive is most of this innovation is enabled by technology, and these are technology folks who are actually looking at some of these things and trying and failing it, but retrying and actually enabling it. So from that perspective, right, if I am a business, established business, and if I have my own IT, and if I'm looking at this and saying, okay, if this is what the future entails for me, what do I do? Or if I'm a CIO, what should I be thinking? One big thing is happening out there is the CIO role itself is changing. Today, CIO is no longer responsible for managing servers. Today, CIO is being asked in terms of telling me how much revenue are you getting in and how much profit are you making for the company. If that is what a CIO is being asked, then how can his organization respond to that kind of a onslaught by the new competitors? So some of my thoughts which I've coined in terms of I've looked at a few examples outside. Second, I've kind of tried to gather or kind of generalize some trends that I've seen working with my clients. We do work with a number of startups, we do work with a number of established players. So the example that I'm going to quote forward is basically a combination of both. Sometimes I'll not divulge the names because some are even kind of at least startups and they're just kind of getting the products out. So what can I do to enable business agility? And the first thing the first principle that needs to come out there is business driver or business enabler. I'm not saying business enablement is not important. That's the traditional IT role. We have IT as a function has been enabling business to grow, have been enabling business to achieve its goal. But I think it's time that we keep working there, but we actually start shifting our focus to being a business driver. To take an example, a couple of years ago, the last mile taxi connectivity, especially from airports and things like that, was completely owned by companies like your EasyCab and Meru and Mega, right? Pretty well business. IT-wise also, those guys are pretty good. I mean, they had good call center, they came up with mobile applications, you could develop, you could book car cabs, you could get statuses, all of that pretty well. Until and unless Uber and Ola came and redid the rules. That's innovation, that's business driver. Without making that huge investment, without actually having to own the fleet, without actually having to establish in every city, one central location, these guys have rewritten the entire rules of that last mile connectivity. To an extent where a lot of cities are actually eating into the auto market as well. That to me is what a business driver role of IT needs to be. Make sense? Questions, comments?
I think, I agree everything except one part which I'm not sure. Is the investment part. And specifically for Uber and these companies, I kind of slightly disagree that they didn't invest it. In fact, they quite heavily invested. The way they acquired, the taxi people and all these people, things like that. So that is still.
I'm not saying it is zero investment. Investment is there, but if you look at like a per unit investment in those two models, this is far too less. And that's what it is. If I have the same amount of cash, I'd go this model versus this model. This model I'll completely overtake the market. That's what is happening. So I'm no longer suggesting that, hey, you want, let's go out and we'll start a company and we'll take over the world. That's not what I'm talking about. The second principle out there, which I think is going to be pretty important for IT, is leading innovation over enabling efficiency gain. Again, IT traditionally, we have been looking at processes, we have been looking at things and trying to make the business as efficient as possible. We'll make sure that we can save as much cost as possible to make the business run efficiently, to make it more profitable. But I think it's time where the rules have been rewritten and we need to continue to focus on it, but move our focus also to leading innovation. Does that make sense? Yeah. I think one of the sectors which in the next few years is going to be badly disrupted in India is the primary healthcare. I'm not talking about tertiary healthcare here, I'm not talking about big hospitals, I'm talking about primary healthcare. There's a problem in primary healthcare which exists in the rural market, all of us know. While in the urban market, in the group that we are sitting here, we are very well served. I mean, we have access to good doctors, we can go, we'll pay and all of it, right? the number of companies that I have come across, we are working with actively, and I know some of the other people are actually developing, where they're completely rewriting the rules of primary healthcare. It's a combination of open hardware, internet, and technology. Primary healthcare will no longer be delivered at a clinic, it will be delivered at your home at your doorstep. The first experiment that's out there is Healthcare at Home, which is a Delhi-based company. They started a few years ago, and they were pretty much the pioneer in that whole thing. But there are a few companies that we are working with which are kind of five steps ahead of them. We're talking about specialists either using technology and actually doing it for you at your home, home visits, even diagnosis. They enable you, they put devices at your place, it's very minimalistic cost, open handle kind of stuff. They can monitor you, doctor out there sitting in a different city can monitor and actually work through the whole thing. That's innovation. That's looking at what are the technology trends emerging and how to do that. And not stopping there, these guys are actually pumping all that data into a big data platform and actually running analytics on that and saying, okay, if this is my kind of patient base, what is the probability of this person getting certain things and how do I actually prevent it beforehand? That's the power that these doctors will have in front of them when they actually interact with you. And the machine will actually be able to diagnose me. There's still human interaction, but is that being made more efficient and are we rewriting the rules in terms of innovating on those interactions? I think that's what the key is. I don't think we are still in that era where it will be all machines and the machine will come and do everything and I'll be comfortable with that. I keep saying the future that we used to see in Star Trek when we were kids is probably knocking at our doors today. The third principle that I think is pretty important for enabling business agility is leading customer engagement over supporting customer engagement. The example that I take there is look at education, and Coursera and Udacity came in and tried to rewrite the whole thing. But the problem with Coursera and Udacity is has anyone taken a Coursera course? How do you find it?
I like it.
You like it? There are very few people who are actually able to continue to the end of the course, or who are able to continue through multiple courses. Definitely there are people, they are not in a zero way, there's a minority of people. You need a lot of inner drive to be able to do that, because the problem with Coursera is that if you don't have the inner drive, right, then it is not engaging enough and assignment and submit all of it, it'll do. One of the clients that we are working with is again trying to rewrite the rules there. Not in the same segment though, they're trying with a very different segment. It's a social startup trying to focus on the K+5, kindergarten plus 5 years of education, looking at basic stuff, but trying to create a platform which could be delivered using devices like these and is 200% engaging to the kids, as engaging as a game. And kids will work on the platform and will learn. And mind it, some of the best brains in the world in terms of learning and psychology are working on that platform. And a huge team of data scientists is working on in terms of understanding every interaction and interpreting and so how do we make it more and more engaging for the kid. I think something like that comes out and the initial results are pretty encouraging. We are experimenting right now with a number of government schools, private schools kind of taking their prototypes and then seeing how things are, and the results are pretty encouraging in terms of how those algos are telling us where kids are, what they need to learn next, and all the real-time stuff. That comes in, we're talking about completely rewriting how this entire K+5 education is being driven. a lot of schools are going to have a good run for their money. And you're talking about this being an open source and freely available in India. Completely filling it out. Make sense? Elevate is one step in that direction.
Yeah.
Is there a like five steps ahead?
Yes.
So we're talking about running the whole platform for across India with a 20-member team, not even 25-member team.
Yeah, it's pretty engaging.
Yeah.
Works like a game.
Keep learning it. And the key is it looks at things like, okay, here's the concept, here are the micro concepts, here is exactly what you don't know. Let me put these things in there. And you learn this, and then I will put an assessment, I'll assess you, yes, you are able to learn this, you have learned it, move on. The fourth and the last principle that I think out there is important or enables is, work on revenue generation over cost saving. Again, traditional IT, we worked a lot on efficiency, we worked a lot on cost saving, trying to cut cost as much as possible. But I think it needs to change from just being a cost saver to actually look at revenue generation. How can I do that? One key example that comes to my mind here is, this is one of the clients, it's a large equipment manufacturer that we are working in, Globe's world's largest equipment manufacturer. With the economic downturn and all of it, the demand for equipment was low because of economic situations. Second, they were being onthorned by a lot of Chinese brands, which were a lot more cheaper. And they're kind of having a run for their money in terms of what do we do. Until someone had this brainwave saying, you know what? Even today, the installed base of equipment out there in the world is largest from us. What if we just go after the servicing market of it? Cool, good idea. Servicing and spare parts could be a good business. But how do we go about it? The problem that these guys had was, they did not know how many equipment exist, where do they exist, and how can I enable my service guys and dealerships to actually go and sell? What we work with them is, we looked at all of their records in terms of sales data, where they are, service data, whatever it is, putting that out, and actually running algos on it to figure out what the current state of equipment is, what is the next set of service that is required, what are the spare parts required, and push that data out to the dealers and saying, look, here is in your area, in your vicinity, here are the opportunities that exist, go run after them. In 2 years' time, the contribution of revenue from profit from service and sales went up from 4% to 10%. That I think is how IT, and this was pretty much an IT initiative when they looked at this business. IT can actually look at revenue generation rather than looking at how can we save more cost and actually be on the forefront. And that is the question which is being asked to the CIOs today. A lot of CIOs that I work with say, look, what my CIO is asking is, tell me how much revenue you are generating. Don't tell me how much cost you are saving, because that's not going to last my business for next 15 years. Does that make sense? Yes, no?
Yes.
Okay, so that's pretty much towards the end of what I had. So what I've tried to do is, all of these, if I took that, they take it and combine it. I think what we are looking at here is sort of a manifesto which IT can have to enabling business agility, which is basically business driver over business enabler, innovation leader over enabling efficiency gain, leading customer engagement over supporting customer engagement, revenue generation over cost saving. The key things here is, the things on the right-hand side are not obsolete. They are as important as they were, because without that, the business will fall apart. But with the changing role and what the environment is changing, I think IT needs to put a decent amount of focus and start working on things on the left-hand side. If the business that you're working with needs to be relevant and be around for next 10, 15 years or whatever time we are thinking about. So that's all what I had in terms of business agility and what ideas I've been toying with. Any question, answers, discussions, anything?
I saw there's a pattern you have used to present your
course, I'm still popularizing it, but this is based on at least, I would say, 2 years of discussions and trying to find out patterns. It was a little over 2 years ago when we first started talking to business agility, and the key, what triggered was the agility said, someone came and said, hey, business agility, let's go and look at agile processes in business. That doesn't make sense, and that had me kind of, me and a few other people kind of started thinking about, talking about it, and really started finding that, okay, there's a trend, there are probably patterns, and there are people out there who are actually defining it. Forrester is already talking about it, Wikipedia is already talking about it. So it is. There is definitely people out there in the globe who are actually thinking about it and talking about it. I don't think the community and noise is large enough today to actually have everyone stop and take a look at saying, looks like things are going to change with them. Anything else? Any other questions? Any comments? Yeah, no, idea there is, I mean, this is, again, this is something that I've been toying for, I said, last 2 years and thinking about trying to form ideas, and I just want to throw it out to people saying, this is what I think is emerging, this is what I think is happening, and last 1 year, it is my belief has grown stronger and stronger, because since the time we actually founded Sahaj, luckily, by stroke of luck, we have about 50% of our clientele comes from startups. Where people come to us with ideas saying, hey, I have this business idea. I don't know if technology, I think this is possible, I don't know if it's possible, and I don't have enough time to explore everything. Can you guys work with us, help us ideate it, create the first version and get it out of the market? And last 1 year, I've seen an increasing trend of a lot of these examples that I'm kind of quoting about, where people are pushing all these things. And I think where these initiatives are, the next 2 years, I'm going to see a complete onslaught by a lot of these guys. Much of these folks are actually having their jobs and these are ideas they're toying with and some of them are pretty successful as well. Surprisingly, a lot of them are domestic players. A lot of startups in India which are actually completely trying to redefine how things are done here. It's very interesting, and actually in my previous company we were not looking at this, and these, I don't know what happened once we co-founded Sahaj, a lot of people kind of approached us and we realized that this whole thing is pretty strong. There are a bunch of, even e-commerce, there are a bunch of people that are completely trying to rewrite and look at an e-commerce segment which is in tier 3 cities which is not served, and how do we go about serving that. Pretty interesting ideas out there that people are working with, and well funded. Idea came before, data was one way of kind of enabling that idea. For example, when I talk about the equipment manufacturer, data in that case was when I talk about healthcare, the whole data pipe that these guys are building is probably the next step. The first thing is to actually take the whole healthcare, primary healthcare to your doorsteps. Which is where the data gathering will start. And then will come the next round where the doctor will have access to all of these statistical models and analysis to corroborate what doctor is trying to think about.
I guess for primary healthcare, a lot of things are going on from last 6-7 years, 10 years.
Yeah, I mean,
but main thing is our industry is not agile.
No, see, the problem there is, and that is why what I've realized is a lot of these guys wanted to work in the rural sector and they have shifted their focus to urban sector now.
Right.
They've completely shifted their focus to urban sector and they are going after the market which is sitting in this room. Yes.
So for where home delivery of medicine and vaccination for
yes.
Post-pandemic.
Yeah.
And everything was ready, but in that project could not go because they didn't want to spend.
True.
The government didn't want.
True. No, that definitely was a trend. And my thing today is that these guys have come now coming after the urban market saying, okay, fine, there is not.
Because the process, product, everything is ready, so they are selling it to private or NGOs.
Exactly. See, it's always a combination of service and the product that actually ultimately we want. I can have the best product, but if service is not there, then probably I'll not.
LG was the first in consumer electronic to what is 2 hours response time and then two days fixing and 7 days replace the two things in on time.
Yeah. But thing is, the big damage that LG had done is already done. So the market is gone.
Okay, you were saying that technology is driving the new products and services. So means it is also influencing the customer behavior. So in that case, organization needs to keep on eye how the things are changing, how customer behaviors are changing. So this is the deep analysis of external environment. So how to do this constant analysis? Because it is also analysis of competition along with the customer changing behavior.
So okay, there are two things that we are talking about. One is our traditional way of analyzing the competition and seeing how do we stay ahead of them. The second thing which we are talking about here, I think, is becoming more important given where we are right now in terms of environmental factors. Is looking at these environmental factors. One picture which comes to my mind very, very common is the scene from a living room where in the evening typically the whole family used to sit about 5 years ago and watch TV. So the TV is on, but everyone is on the mobile as well. That's a huge change. You don't engage with the customers there, you engage your customers with your customers there. And unless and you are looking at some of those things, and see, we don't need to look. I don't think we need to go outside and find something. Things are happening in our homes, at our places. Look at how our kids are responding to technology, how they use it. That's the future.
Yeah. Let's take an example of grocery. You say that today, 1 month back, I used to go on more. Now I am shopping from the Zomato. But sometime I go to the grocery shop. So how the customer behaviors are changing with the, and how to keep balance with the traditional things and with new technology. So how companies can analyze these factors constantly? Because technology is changing. And we need to bring the products and services based on the current trend.
Yes.
And we need to keep change with the time.
So that's a challenge that people, and that's why I said, a big part of this needs to start coming from IT, because we are the guys who have to understand and who can be on the cutting edge of the technology and see how that can be leveraged. That definitely has to be there. One example that is out there is with the big basket thing coming out. There's a supermarket, I don't know if it's in Delhi called Total. They tried to respond to it, and the way they responded was, you can order your stuff online, but come to the store to pick it up. Doesn't solve the problem. The problem was they were still trying to see, okay, I need to make sure that the footfall in the store is as much as it was earlier. And that fell flat on its face. So you need to come out of that mindset of saying, there's no way I can let go of what is there. You'll have to redefine the business.
This is an example of a mindset. If I look at it another way, when I'm in South Korea, Tesco has put up the virtual printouts of 3D stores with a QR code.
Yeah.
And it helped them to grow from the second to first.
Yeah. That was a huge success.
They were able to success.
Yeah.
So it's about a mindset, how the people behave to that environment.
It's about the mindset, it's about realizing how people's mindset are changing and why they are changing and responding to those environmental changes.
See, the answer to that question is that in India, from last 10 years, people have started enjoying weekend as a grocery. Now, if you tell them order online, then their weekend is gone.
No, but I don't know. If you look at the big basket numbers, and there are three more players, actually in Bangalore, I can talk about it. There are three more numbers and players in Bangalore. It's a big trend.
So in the US and all, they say it is based on that. I don't want to spend time on grocery business. Let me go for
the long weekend. I think one of the things that again, big basket got it right was the understanding of Indian psyche. The best part, what clicked from Big Basket was that I would deliver, you look at it, and that's what you all want. I want to look at what I'm buying. Look at it, don't like it, send it back. In my apartment complex, there are 5 trips that the Big Basket guy makes every single day. And there are only 400 families there. Imagine the volume that's coming out from there.
So
good look, send it back. What you need to do is you need to be making sure that there's enough emphasis on innovation. I think gone are the days when a big player can actually survive by making itself more and more efficient. They need to have a set of people who are actually looking at the trend and trying to redefine the business. Unless until you do that yourself, someone else will do it for you. And then you will always be running behind it. The thing is, either you change or you are forced to change. Cool then, I think we're running out of time as well. Cool, thanks everyone.
Thanks. Thank you.